Okay, so good morning. Today I will discuss about the principle of various techniques for analysis of fields and borders. So there are different techniques which is being used for laboratory analysis of different kind of fields, borders, as well as food, which are being used for human consumption also. So first of all, I would like to discuss about the proximate principles from where they first started. This is also known as Binet system of analysis. So Binet is one of the place which is situated at in Germany, and where the first time a group of scientists under the leadership of Hennberg and Stoneman, they developed the proximate principle. Proximate principle, which contains moisture as crude protein, ether extract, crude fiber, and nitrogen free extract. So these six principles are coming under the proximate principle. Out of that, we can analyze moisture as, that means total as, crude protein, ether extract, crude fiber in laboratory. And after analyzing this, we can calculate the nitrogen free extract. So nitrogen free extract can be calculated from these parameters. So these are the six parameters, main component of the proximate principles and fractions of this proximate analysis. So this is very much important. So any kind of the feed, whatever we are procuring or we are offering to the animals, we must go these principles. We must analyze this principle so that we know the quality of the feed initially. So these are important parameters to know about the, to judge the quality of the feed. So dry matter is very much important. In case of dry fodder, green fodder, and in case of grains like maize and other grains also, cereal grains, where dry matter is very much important, that influence the prices of the feed. So like inorganic matter, we can calculate, we can analyze these inorganic matter in the form of total as. So after burning at optimum temperature or particular temperature in muffle furnace, and the temperature should be more than 600 degrees centigrade almost. For certain temperature may vary according to that time slightly. So for certain time, we can burn the samples. And after decarbonization, after carbon-free sample, we can burn at high temperature in muffle furnace and we can get the inorganic component, whatever the left in the samples. So we can estimate the total as. And accordingly, from that sample only, the total as sample, we can estimate the acid insoluble as. So these all are related parameters. First go for dry matter, then we can burn the decarbonize the sample, then burn in the furnace, that means inorganic material left. And from that inorganic material, we can go for the analysis of the acid insoluble as, that is the sand and silica we can estimate. Okay, so accordingly, when HCl treated with the HCl, and after treatment with the warm HCl and after some boiling, we can filter it. And after filter it, the filtrate contains the inorganic minerals and the left residue left in the filter paper, which is sand and silica. So we should know the acid, sand and silica component or sand and silica content of the feed material. So by that way, we can judge the quality of the feed as well. So crude protein, which is very much important. So we can analyze the nitrogen content of the feed in laboratory. And after getting the data of the nitrogen, we multiply by the factor 6.25. So after that, we can get protein percentage. Ether extract is also very much important. And because we should know the oil content of the feed. So that extraction of the ether from any samples, we have to follow and we have to use the instrument, that is the SOX slit apparatus. And petroleum ether is required. And we can, and that means refluxing the samples with the petroleum ether for certain time, and we, by that way, we can extract the oil content of the feed. So whatever the residue left in the round bottom flask or oil flask, that will be measured, and by difference, we can calculate the measurement of the oil. We should know the oil content of the feed. So for fiber extraction, crude fiber extraction, sample should be fat-free. So before going for estimation of the crude fiber, we should go for the ether extraction of the sample, which the sample should be fat-free. And that fat-free sample will be used for the crude fiber estimation. So in case of crude fiber estimation, we boil that fat-free sample with weak acid and weak alkali for such a period of time. That time period and method is available in the manual, laboratory manual of our department. So you should go with this manual and know the method how we can measure these approximate principles. And after that boiling with weak acid and alkali, dry the sample, residue, whatever the residue left, and then burn it, and then measure the after burning, pull the samples, and then measure the differences, initial weight and final weight. So whatever the difference coming is the crude fiber. So accordingly, we can calculate the crude fiber content of the feed. We can calculate by this way, we can calculate nitrogen free extract, that is the soluble sugars or soluble carbohydrate which is present in the feed. So by that way, we should know the approximate principles. We should know the quality of the feed by a simple methods. And within 1 or 2 days, we can perform these all parameters in the laboratory. So moisture, one by one, I would like to discuss one by one, that the moisture is very much important constituent for all plants material as well as the animals also. So determination of moisture, how we can determine the moisture in the laboratory or from the any feed, how we should know the moisture. Nowadays, moisture meter is available in the market. So automatic, we can then put the sample in this meter and that meter will show you the moisture percentage of this feed. How much moisture is present in this particular feed. So immediately they show you. So nowadays it is widely used in the in practice in factory feed plants, and supplier also they have. Before buying any grains, they ensure the moisture content of the feed, because moisture will also affect the keeping quality. So higher moisture may be the chance of invitation of the fungal infestation in the feed also. So they all cautions, the supplier and buyers taking care of. So they have this machine, moisture meters. In laboratory, we can estimate the moisture content by the use of the hot air oven equipment. So hot air oven at 100 degrees centigrade of particular length of the time, which is mentioned in our laboratory manuals. You also go through this, and by that way we can estimate in laboratory by using of hot and loss of gait, which occurs is the moisture. And left material is the dry matter content. So we can calculate the moisture content and we can calculate the dry matter content as well. So the what is the significance of the moisture? Actually, moisture content of the feed, which may vary consequently, and it may affect the nutritive value of the feed. It may affect the shelf life of the feed. So significance of calculating is the cost per unit weight of the feed, and classification of feed, which is of succulent and non-succulent type. So moisture content is significant in the storage of the feed as well. So these are the significance of the moisture. So dry matter, which is calculated by weighing after drying constant weight at hot in hot air oven and at 100 plus minus 1 or 2 degrees centigrade, and we try to constant the temperature, but if certain deviation 1 degree or 2 degree, it doesn't affect the calculation parameters. And however, the moisture content of a liquid feed like molasses, milk, or feed that having high moisture content, like green fodder, like that. So, preferably we dry these kind of the sample on less temperature. I start with the less temperature. We can slowly increase the temperature. So we start with the 50 degree centigrade, and then slowly we can increase 100. Plus degree centigrade. So accordingly, hay, grasses, silage, these are also we should go for the pre-drying of the samples before estimating the, or samples which have high starch content. So that will be, that needs a pre-drying of the sample at 60 to 70 degree centigrade. After that, after pre-drying, we can go for the optimum temperature, whatever required for dry matter estimation. Accordingly, for estimation of dry matter in silage, which is very much important. So silage contains volatile components. So volatile components may be lost during the oven drying. So we should preserve it. And so method of dry matter estimation for silage is the toluene distillation. We can go for toluene distillation, and toluene is used for the estimation of the dry matter in silage. So determination of dry matter in silage by the toluene distillation process, and dry matter in silage is calculated from the volume of water which is removed by distillation in presence of toluene. So how much volume of water is being removed by distillation in presence of toluene, and titrimetrically determination of the total acidity of the distillate, which is used to correct the measured volume of the distillate for the volume which is occupied by the volatile fatty acids. So by that way we can estimate the dry matter content of the silage. Likewise, determination of moisture content in molasses. So NDRI Karnal developed one method, dairy research, known as dairy research method, to know the moisture content of molasses. Molasses is also a type of the liquid feed which is widely used and used as binding material as well as the flavoring agent. In mostly in cattle feed, they are being used, and up to 5 to 10% level. And so estimating the moisture in molasses by disintegrating the carbohydrate moiety with the help of hydrochloric acid and completely extracting it. Thereby the bonded water with the help of gyro. So this is one of a method to a research method to know the moisture content of molasses. So crude protein, which is very much important to know the wild cakes quality, to know the protein content, to know the protein rich feed ingredients. They may be the vegetable source or animal source. So crude protein is very much important. So estimation of the crude protein, we should estimate the nitrogen content of that particular feed in the laboratory by adopting the Jeldahl procedure, Jeldahl methods, and some automatic machine is also coming nowadays, and crude protein estimation unit automatically they contain the NIRS, near infrared spectroscopy. They can also tell the protein content of the feed and proximate composition of the feed. But in weight method, we should go for the Jeldahl procedure where the organic matter is digested by heating in concentrated sulfuric acid and some catalytic agent is also to enhance the reaction, and that will help in the digestive process. So we can use a digestion mixture, and from the nitrogen containing organic molecules, ammonium sulfate is formed, and amount of ammonia which is estimated by the distillation. Then after distillation, whatever the collected in the conical flask, then we titrate against the standard acid solution. So after titration, we note down the volume of standard acid consumed. So by that way, we can calculate the protein content, crude protein percentage, that is the nitrogen content into 6.2 factors. So accordingly, we can calculate the crude protein. And crude fat, we can calculate, we can estimate that the crude fat, which is known as ether extract. So ether extract, we can use this succinate apparatus. That feed contains combination of the fat, that is free fatty acids, esters of the fatty acid, neutral fat, acetyls, different vitamins. They also contains, carotene also contains. So we should that combinedly they extracted from the sample when used the petroleum ether of boiling point. That petroleum ether have boiling point 40 to 60 degrees centigrade. Carbohydrate which is made up of nitrogen free extract and food. So NF is also known as soluble carbohydrate, which consists of water, soluble vitamins, monosaccharides, oligosaccharides, and polysaccharides. So insoluble carbohydrate, that is known as the crude fiber, which is mainly having hemicellulose and cellulose, that is the polysaccharide component. And the residue of a feed which is insoluble after successive boiling with dilute acid, and we estimate the crude fiber content in laboratory. We boil the sample, fat-free sample, with the dilute acid and dilute alkali. And the residue left after certain period of time after boiling, this is the carbohydrate fraction. This is the crude fiber fraction, and which contains, besides the cellulose, some part of the nitrogen is also present in that. So crude fiber, which gives an indication of bulkiness of the feed. This is very much important. So crude fiber gives an indication of bulkiness of the feed. As can be estimated in the laboratory, after estimation of the dry matter, we can estimate the ice sample. So first we decarbonize the sample by burning this sample on a heater or hot plate. After burning, we place this decarbonized sample in the muffle furnace, and we on this muffle furnace and we set the temperature 550 degrees centigrade, and we burn this sample in the muffle furnace. After some period of the time, we get the sample back from the muffle furnace and kept in desiccator for cooling. After cooling, we can weigh the samples, and by that way, we can know the organic component of it. So, one such method of partitioning of fiber, we have to discuss about these methods. This method contains NDF, nutrient detergent fiber, and ADF, acid detergent fiber. So, neutral detergent fiber, which this method utilizes detergent. We can use different detergent for making the solution of the NDF, NDS solution. So, this utilizes the detergent which complex with the protein to render it soluble, and utilizes a chelating agent, that is the EDTA. EDTA acts as chelating agent, which removes the heavy metals from the aliquot and from the samples and alkaline earth contaminations. So this is the purpose of application of the EDTA, which is a winding material. So the procedure which involves in separation of the feed dry matter into two fractions, that is high digestible and low digestible. High digestible and low digestible. By boiling 1 gram of feed sample in NDS solution contains 3% sodium lauryl sulfate, buffering the pH of that solution is around 7, that means the neutral pH. We boil it for 1 hour and filter it. So NDF, which considerably high lignin, it contains high amount of lignin and hemicellulose, which includes the NDF fraction. We should know this fraction is the NDF fraction, neutral detergent fiber fractions. And the CP content of this neutral detergent fiber fraction is neutral detergent insoluble crude protein. So NDICP, we can say that. And NDF, which can be equated with the cell wall content of the grasses as well as cereals. So like that, after estimation of the NDF, ADF, that is the acid detergent fiber, the process which is used for the purpose of determining the lignin content of the forest samples. So ADF procedure is being used, and it involves boiling of 1 gram sample, feed samples, in an acid detergent solution for 1 hour. And after that, we filter the samples. And the insoluble makeup, that is the acid detergent fiber. So NDF subtracted by ADF is equal to hemicellulose. We can calculate the hemicellulose content. So NDF subtracted with the ADF is equal to hemicellulose content. That sample also contains limited amount of the protein that I have discussed, that is the NDICP. So how we can calculate the acid detergent lignin and permanganate lignin in that samples, that ADF samples? So to determine the amount of lignin which is present in that sample, that is the ADF, which is then digested with the 72% H2SO4. So first we prepare the 72% H2SO4 solution, and we can digest the ADF sample into 72% H2SO4 for 3 hours. And Then after we can wash the sample, we can filter the samples. And the residue which is remaining after washing and drying, actually we perform this in a crucible. So we directly dry the crucible. So drying is, after drying we weigh it and burn it. That means burn in a maple furnace, so ice it. So we know the differences in weight, and that differences is the loss of weight is the ADL. Whatever left is ADL, acid detergent, lignin. So remaining as sample, the approximate the silica present in that sample. So while the loss in weight during acid approximate the lignin content. And this lignin content is referred as acid detergent lignin, or specifically acid insoluble lignin, which is not soluble in the acidized well. So by that way, we can calculate the acid detergent lignin. And one alternative method for determining the lignin, which has advantage for certain materials, not for all, which has advantage for certain materials, which involves the oxidation of lignin of acid detergent fiber. Oxidation of lignin of acid detergent fiber with an excess of acetic acid buffered potassium permanganate solution. Acetic acid buffered potassium permanganate solution. So lignin determined by this method is referred as permanganate lignin. So this method may be used to allow for the cutene, which is present mainly in the seeds hull. Seed may present hota hai. Otherwise, it would be measured as lignin only. How we can estimate or determine the true protein and non-protein nitrogen in laboratory? So insoluble protein, which is left by precipitation with a suitable precipitates or precipitating agent, sometimes PVPP and other material, which is other chemical which is used, triacetic acid like that, which is used for precipitation of the protein. So agent after filtering non-protein nitrogenous compound, which is termed true protein. That means crude protein minus NPN is equal to true protein. So non-protein nitrogen, which is calculated by differences between the total crude protein nitrogen and the value of precipitated true nitrogen. True protein nitrogen. By that way, we can, by difference, we can calculate the NPN component of that particular feed. So various precipitating agent commonly used as tungstic acid, trichloroacetic acid, that is the TCA, which is well known precipitating agent for protein estimation, true protein estimation. And we are presently using this TCA, trichloroacetic acid, in a laboratory for precipitation of the other sources of the nitrogen and for estimation of this true protein. Copper hydroxide is also used, zinc barium hydroxide is also used, and other chemicals are also being used as precipitating agent. So determination of free fatty acids. How we can determine the free fatty acid component in any feed order? So free fatty acid, which are extracted from lipid part of the feed samples, and by using Dahl's extraction mixture. That Dahl's extraction mixture, which contains heptane, isopropanol, and acetic acid in the ratio of 40:10:1. So we can prepare a mixture solution, heptane, isopropanol, and acetic acid with a ratio of 40, 10, and 1. So free fatty acid forms a complex with the cupric ions when mixed with the copper reagent. So they form complex, and colored complex formed with the copper, which is soluble in chloroform and diethion carbamate, which is used as color developer. So accordingly, we can we should know that we can determine the free fatty acid concentration in the feed. Like that mineral, which is very much important. And mineral, know about the minerals. We always know that the importance of and significance of mineral in feed, and the significance of minerals in animals as well as humans. So even deficiency and excess of minerals sometimes occur, and that shows that reflects the health of the animals as well. So if there is any deficiency of minerals, certain minerals in the feed, they affect the health of the animal. And simultaneously, when we consuming the product of the animal as well as the product of the agriculture, we also human health is also being affected. So mineral is very much important. We should know we have to estimate the mineral content of the feed and fodder in laboratory to ensure the quality of the particular feed. So first major mineral, which is the calcium, which is very much important. So first time that in India, the Talpatra method is being adopted for estimation of the calcium. Dr. Talpatra is a professor at Mathura Veterinary College, and they designed the experiment, and they give the procedure of estimation of calcium in the feeds and fodders. So when a solution which contains calcium, which is treated with the ammonium oxalate, then all the calcium present is in the particular sample, which is precipitated as calcium oxalate. And precipitate on treatment with the sulfuric acid, that precipitate is treated with sulfuric acid and dissolve it, forming calcium sulfate, and which is liberated free oxalic acid. And such oxalic acid, which is quantitatively estimated by the titration against a standard KMnO4, and we are using NY10 KMnO4 solution to arrive at the calcium content which is present in the given solution. So by that way, we can calculate the calcium concentration, calcium, to know the calcium content of the feed. And 1 ml of NY10 KMnO4 potassium permanganate solution is equal to 2 milligram of the calcium. So this is a very easy method, a very simple method. By adopting this method, we can know the calcium content of the feed. So estimation of phosphorus, which is present in the ice solution. Phosphorus is also very much important along with the calcium. And we should try to balance the calcium-phosphorus ratio in the diet for optimum utilization of the both major minerals. So phosphorus present in the ash solution, which is precipitated as ammonium phosphomolybdate, and precipitate is washed till free from acid and dissolved in a known excess amount of the standard NY10 NaOH. So sodium hydroxide solution, we should prepare NY10 sodium hydroxide solution for titration, and excess alkali, which is back titrated against the standard NY10 HCl to arrive at exact quantity of a standard NY10 sodium hydroxide required in that particular samples during titration. So we can calculate the phosphorus, that is a 1 ml standard NY10 NaOH, which is equal to 0.1347 milligram of phosphorus. So again, we can estimate the phosphorus by using these methods in easy manner in laboratory. Nowadays, it is very practically used in different laboratory, that is a spectrophotometry. Application of use of the atomic absorption spectrophotometry, that is AAS, for estimation of minerals content of the feed and fodder. So for that, we should digest, first we should digest the sample in triacidic mixture. That is a suitable quantity of sample which is oxidized with a mixture of acids like perchloric acid, sulfuric acid and nitric acid. In particular ratio, that is 0.5:1:4, and the material which is brought into the solution with triple glass distilled water, because water is also contain some amount of the minerals. So that water which is used for preparation of the distillate or eliquate for estimation of the mineral, that water should be free from any kind of minerals. So triple glass distilled water is always being used for preparation of the eliquate, preparation of the sample for mineral analysis. So procedure for oxidizing organic substances by using acid and oxidizing agent. Minerals are solubilized without volatilization, and we ensure that some minerals are volatile in nature. So combustion of the sample of feed, fodder and other samples, which is carried out by triple acid digestion mixture, a triple acid digestion method, that is a bait oxidation process of digestion. And we should follow the parameters whatever used for estimation of minerals by this atomic absorption spectrophotometry. And there is different kind of the lamps, cathode lamps, and different lamps. And for different minerals, different lamp is being used in the machine, particular machine like copper, zinc. So other lamps are being used for estimation of the particular minerals. Like that, the flame photometer, which is an important instrument, which is used in inorganic chemical analysis to determine the concentration of different metals like sodium, potassium, calcium, lithium, etc. So the principle of flame photometer, when an alkali metal salt is drawn into a non-luminous flame, it will ionize first, absorb the energy from the flame, and then emit lights of a characteristic wavelength. As the excited atom decay to unexcited ground state. So this is the principle of flame photometer. And the element emission wavelength and color emitted, like for estimation of the sodium, the wavelength is 589 and they emit yellow color. Potassium wavelength is 766, they emit violet color. Barium, they emit lime green color. Calcium wavelength is 662, they emit orange color. And lithium wavelength is 670, they emit red color. So by emission of the color, we know the presence of the element, what element is present. We also colorimetrically, we can estimate different trace elements, and colorimetric analysis is a method for determining the concentration of different chemical element or chemical compound in a solution with the aids of the color reagent. Colorimetry means application of color. We determine the color of that compound, that solution. So detect the color. So application to both organic compound and inorganic compound, and which may be used with or without any enzymatic stage. So this is also one simple method to estimate the minerals from a biological sample as well as other samples. Estimation of anti-nutritional factors. We know the feed also contains some anti-nutritional factors, mainly phenolic compound. And this phenolic compound, they react with the choline CA carbuic acid. That is known as FC reagent at alkaline pH, which gives absorption. This absorption maximum at 725 nanometer. So these absorbance is being used for estimation of the phenolic component by application of the FC reagent. So for estimation of the simple phenolic compound, that is non-trailing phenolics, so PVPP, that is the polyvinyl polypyrolidone, polyvinyl polypyrolidone, that is PVPP, which has the property to bind with the tannin. So for estimation of the non-tannin phenolic, we use these chemicals to bind with the tannin, and that will not affect the simple phenolics. So tannin and extract containing tannin as well as the phenolic compound can be removed by the precipitation with PVPP, and filtrate can be used for estimation of the non-tannin phenolic compounds. How we can estimate the tannin compound? So pure tannin, which can be estimated by the different method, that is subtracting non-tannin phenolic compound from the amount of the total phenolic present in the feed samples. And when we go for the condensed tannin estimation, then we use the butanol HCl reagent. So butanol HCl reagent, in presence of this reagent, butanol HCl, the development of color. So once color will be developed, then we go for absorption. Absorptions in the spectrophotometer and absorbance can be measured at 550 nanometers. So that will give the concentration of the condensed tannin in this particular feed. And total tannin we can estimate by titrating against KMnO4 in presence of indigo carbine. So this is the volumetric method, and that volumetric method can be applied for estimation of the total tannin content in the feed. Like that, estimation of miomycine, which is extractable in dilute HCl, and it gives color reagent. Color reaction with ferric chloride reagent, which can be measured at 535 nanometers. And some non-starch polysaccharide, which can also be estimated directly by application of these spectrophotometers. So like that, we can also by calculation, by use of the application of the different formula, we can know the concentration of the non-starch polysaccharides in the feed samples. So this is about the today class, and thank you. If you have any question, you may ask.